Hello, I'd like to introduce you to this series of mine called The Ecstatics, and it's an audio series. I've crafted it over several years, and they are monologues set to really beautiful music, in which I go deep into the lives of these certain people who I've chosen, who all have in common the theme of love in their life. So they led lives of great love and great exploration into the theme of love through different cultures, through different periods of history in different ways. And I hope that it's a free series, so I hope that they are soothing during times, difficult times like now. And many people really love them and use them as a way of reassuring ourselves, remembering ourselves of the things that are really truly important in life, which is the theme of love and our heart. And when all else drops away, really that's all that we're left with. And it therefore becomes like the very quintessence of what it means to be alive, to be a human. And so many people I know use these and fall asleep listening to them, or I've known also certain people have used them in preparation for death. They're very powerful, they're very meditative, and they can, I hope, give you solace during these difficult times. So they're my gift to you, from my heart to yours. I hope you enjoy them, I hope you find them elevating and inspirational. And thank you very much. And here they are. Welcome to another ecstatic. This may even be my last one in this series. I don't know. I like sevens. Let's take some deep breaths just to begin. Deep breath down into the belly, into the chest. Down into the belly, opening the chest. Now into the back of the heart, the shoulder blades. Now breathe into the neck, the back of the neck. And finally, right down into the base of the spine. The ecstatic is a breather, one of the greatest breathers. The ecstatic breathes into whatever experience comes towards him or her. It doesn't matter if it's pain-filled or if it's pleasure-filled. We breathe equally into both, receiving it with utter and absolute trust. The ecstatic dances in eternity. We are alive in the body, flooding the software of our DNA with the light of the Christ consciousness, with the light of pearls, pearls of eternity, droplets of divinity, dripping down our spines. And now we drop together into the very base of ecstasy. Because ecstasy must rise up from somewhere. There must be a field in which it is born, an egg, a mystery, a womb out of which it grows. And this womb is the silence, the emptiness, of ecstasy. And today we journey into this womb space where ecstasy itself emanates from. And even where ecstasy one day will return to. For even ecstasy has its dance. It requires a form. Even the subtlest of forms has to have its play, its rapture, before it dives back from the place that it was born from into eternity. And so we dive into this silence, this tinkling silence of the womb. And today I've chosen a man, or at least he's come to me. He's another man with no name. His name, if he ever had one, is long lost. He's become known as Cold Mountain. He's named after the place where he lived. This is rather like Mother Julian, the medieval ecstatic. She's the one I began this journey with. She was named after the church in which she spent her life. So Cold Mountain was named after the mountain that he lived on and in and under and even within. And we're traveling, time traveling, to ancient China, to Southeast China. I'm going to begin in the 7th century. That's roughly when this man lived. But I'm going to break some rules again. Oh dear, the ecstatic in me can't remain in any way consistent. You know, constancy is the final refuge of the unimaginative. I'm not only going to talk about Cold Mountain, his name is Han Shan in Chinese. I'm only going to use him as a launch pad, as a entry point, as a portal into a whole ecstatic realm, the realm of ancient Chinese wilderness poetry. A world of misty mountains, of echoing silence, the occasional peal of a temple bell. And this world stands at the very threshold of our memory. It's a world of sages, of pilgrims and vagabond masters. A world which gave rise to the Zen tradition. But this is the Zen before it was Zen, before it became something, before it even became a tradition or a teaching. This is the world out of which the Tao was born. It was Taoism before it became an ism. And it poured into the world through this landscape, famously called the Rivers and Mountains. Rivers and Mountains poetry. The Rivers and Mountains tradition. And it's given us some of the most beautiful words and dreamscapes. It's a transmission of silence and simplicity, of emptiness and purity. Where the moisture of the timeless mosses encrusting the great rocks of the bowing valleys fell upon the empty minds of the sages who inhabited these mountains. And it drips down to us through the centuries, like water through rock, to pierce our modern time-crazed brains and crack us open to the ecstasy of silence and spaciousness and a vast and empty inner landscape that can never be tarnished or polluted or dug up or built upon or ruined in any way, because it lives inside us. It always has lived inside us, and it always will, for all eternity. Cold Mountain is just one voice hanging in this inner wilderness. There are others, a whole stream of them, and each voice, each song adds something. A leaf frond to the tree, a note to the tune, a bird singing at the dawn of the world. Each different, each variegated, delicate and quivering, like a faded tapestry that if you were to touch it, it would break apart. So delicate, so subtle. So we must enter this mystic stream from silence. And we must allow it to envelop us in the silence. And we'll use the words to simply frame the silence. The silence is the thing. The silence is the seed. The seed of the ecstasy. We begin then with this man, Cold Mountain. He's already been discovered by the West. Gary Snyder picked up his poems and shared them with Jack Kerouac in the 60s. So he became a favourite then of the beatniks, which is apt, actually, since he himself was this rebel living at the very fringes of society. And very little is known about him, really just legends. He lived wild in the mountains and he wrote his short poems on rocks around the valleys. You know, and actually no one would ever have recalled him if the local prefect hadn't sent a scribe out sometime after he died to record his wild wilderness poetry. But it's a wonderful idea, isn't it, that this man living in the mountains left his poems etched on the landscape itself. And apparently he used to visit the local Chan monastery, Chan is the Chinese word for Zen, and became friends with a kitchen server there who gave him scraps. There are stories and legends about that friendship. As usual, all kinds of ideas abound about his biography, and beautifully, no one really knows. All we have is the poems. And these poems that we have, or around 300 of them, these are probably the work of several different poets, people. there are some that have a sense, such a sense of silent emptiness in them. They kind of seem to live in their own category. So these are some of the ones I've found to share today. People ask about cold mountain way. Cold mountain road gives out where confusions of ice outlast summer skies. And sun can't thin mists of blindness. So how did someone like me get here? My mind is just not the same as yours. If that mind of yours were like mine, you'd be right here in the midst of this. This is classic Cold Mountain. He's almost issuing a challenge, isn't he? He doesn't often refer to us, to the reader, to the witness. But here he's leaving a message on some rock, a challenge, his legacy. And we have to remember that this is early language. These are Chinese characters freshly forming from the void, with multiple meanings and hidden paths inside them, just like those mountain tracks made by the wild animals that he, Han Shan, spent his life following. So really, these poems are untranslatable, but the silence, you can hear the silence. I've lived out tens of thousands of years on Cold Mountain. Given to the seasons, I vanished among forests and cascades, gazed into things so utterly themselves. No one ventures up into all these cliffs, hidden forever in white mist and cloud. It's just me. Thin grass, my sleeping mat, and azure heaven, my comforting quilt. Happily pillowed on stone, I'm given to heaven and earth, changing on and on. This one particularly resonates with me. I used to have a tiny house up in the Scottish Highlands. I was left some money when I was younger at university, and I brought this very remote croft house. We call them crofts in Scotland, shepherd's house. It was very cheap, very basic. And I went there to live in my 20s. I was at university in Edinburgh. So I would go up to the cottage, the croft, for 3 or 4 days at a time. And in the holidays, I'd go for longer, for months sometimes. And it was in a remote glen. The glen is a valley. It was really, really quiet. No one else up there. this little track leading up, 2 miles up into the glen. Just another little farm up there on the other side of the valley. And I'd wander the hills alone and the forests, huge forests there. And I'd follow the rivers and the streams. And there was nothing there. Nothing. No human habitations. Just wilderness. I'd be out sometimes all day, sometimes several days, just out, like Hanshan. Sometimes I'd sleep out there. And I'd find these remote cliff faces and tangled trees, and I'd wonder if anyone had ever seen them before. And the silence was vast. It was occasionally framed by the mysterious croak of a raven. Yeah, one of the only birds you'd find up there, except for eagles high on the cliff tops. The silence of those days and that place was so vast. Just the sound of the river. There was this one river running down the valley with its streams and tributaries. And you could hear that, unless you went up high onto the hills, and then even you wouldn't hear that, just the wind. I named it the River Now. And there was just this emptiness out there. And you could walk for miles and miles and miles and see nothing and no one. And then I'd come back into my little croft, and I'd feel so strange, like I was pregnant, like everything that I'd just absorbed of that wilderness was somehow inside me. And that silence would continue. And something of that time still remains in me now. That's why I'm so drawn to these ancient poets. Because I'm in a completely different life phase now. Yeah, and I have a family and busyness and hubbub, and I live in a village and with its different sounds and sights and smells, and I'm busy and I work and I do this and I use words, and they all come out of this silence. But the silence that never leaves you once you've tasted that kind of silence. So let's make a little leap and we'll come back to Coal Mountain, because I want to go into another very amazing rivers and mountains poet, Tufu. And let's frame the times a little. You know, it was around the beginning of the 8th century and Chinese civilization was at the pinnacle of its development. There was an impeccable government. Can you imagine that? The country was at peace, the common people were prospering, and there was a huge cultural renaissance underway. I mean, this was a magical time. And then suddenly, this terrible civil war broke out. And it left 2/3 of the population of the entire country either dead or homeless as refugees. Can you imagine from that level of peace and prosperity to that extreme chaos? And Tufu was a poet. Well, he wasn't. He was a normal man among these families trying to find peace. And in the end, like many of those poets, he just became a recluse. This is a pattern we see with these poets. Chinese poets, they became disillusioned with the ways of men, and in the end they chose to retire to the mountains and contemplate. You know, and Tufu is famous for this, his very famous line, "The nation falls into ruins, rivers and mountains continue." Single, beautiful one line where he captures
The whole of human civilization, the nation falls into ruins, rivers and mountains continue. You apply that to our time, the time we're living in. Because everything crumbles. Every empire that isn't built upon truth and love and wisdom eventually crumbles. And rivers and mountains continue. And this is what we find in these poems, the essence of change, of transitoriness, of the letting go of the whole journey of life and death. And out of this, of course, arose this I Ching, this book of changes, this book that has become central to my work as the Gene Keys. So there's a very delicate balance here between despair and beauty. Morning rain. A slight rain comes, bathed in dawn light. I hear it among treetop leaves before mist arrives. Soon it sprinkles the earth and wind-blown follows clouds away. Deepened colours grace thatch homes for a moment. Flocks and herds of things wild all glisten faintly. Then scent of musk opens across half a mountain and lingers on past noon. You see the immediacy of that? It's just a moment hanging in eternity. And he takes us right there with him, right now. The sound of the rain sprinkling the earth and the wind blowing the clouds away. The smell of the musk. The simplicity. The light, the dawn light. He was up early. Whenever you're up early, you have that intensity of the senses. In reply to a letter from Meng, who's gone searching for his old village. After all that loss and ruin, I live at peace, far from Lo Yang summits. Still unravelling this question, cloud hidden peaks all pose. I never leave these thorn bramble depths, north winds, yellow leaves tumbling away, southern streams old age laments. 10 years, a guest of lakes and rivers. This mind, all lingering dusk, grows boundless, boundless. You know, the longer you contemplate, the more you enter into the space of deep contemplation, the more the mind empties out. Another poet, Shailing Yun. We're going back further, to the 4th century. And he found Zen informally by retiring to his family home high in the mountains. He was from one of the wealthiest families in China. And he's known because he really was the seed of the rivers and mountains tradition. You know, remember, it's not just poetry that we're looking at here, but this is a transmission, a movement. It also emerged through art, this incredible art that came from the black and white brush strokes, and calligraphy emerged around the same time. In fact, let me digress for a moment. One of my favorites, as some of you will know, is Hamvas Bella, Hungarian genius. And there's a piece here about where he speaks about the Chinese ink drawings, you know, and he's really emphasizing the difference between, you know, this ancient Oriental art and European art. You know, the Chinese, the ancient Chinese sets out from the emptiness and moves towards the form, rather than the European, which is all about the form defining the emptiness. He makes that point. And he accentuates the importance of the pause. You know, this is what he says. He refers to this sense of space in paintings, you know, as the pause, you know, and it's the foundation of all contemplation. He says that the European image is 98% music and 2% pause, quiet expanse or unbounded silence. And the Chinese is at least 60% silence and 40% music. So the Chinese drawing floats in nothingness. There are pictures in which there is no pause. That is oppressive. That's what he says. It's oppressive when there's no pause in the picture. In a sculpture, the pause consists in what is torso-like, the missing limb or the stone left unworked and raw. So whatever is not said is what is primary. And that is the essence of this Rivers and Mountains tradition. It's what is not said that is really the essence. So back to Shailing. Looking up to the example that old sage handed down, and considering what comes easily to my own nature, I offered myself to this tranquil repose of dwelling, and now nurture my life work in the drift of idleness. Master Pan's early awakening always humbled me, and I was shamed by Master Shang's old age insight. So with years and sickness both closing in upon me, I devoted myself to simplicity and returned to it all. Left that workaday life for this wisdom of wandering, for this wilderness of rivers and mountains clarity. It's challenging for us to grasp this life of emptiness, you know, with our modern day lives so filled with the stuff of activity. And this is why these poems are so relevant today. To me, there is no more relevant art than this. There is no more relevant or needed art today than the art of contemplation. The art of creating inner space to open out our breathing, our thinking, and to slow down. You know, a friend of mine recently told me about her experience of meeting a 185-year-old tortoise, you know, and she said it looked right through her, you know, how it seemed to be suffused with sort of living wisdom of its slow pacing, of what it must have absorbed over its long life. And how can we find this? You know, this art of pausing amidst the sea of our modern world. You know, and our pauses then become like islands of tranquility within the turbulence of the outer world. And we may often feel like these sages did in the ancient times. We can relate to them as war broke out repeatedly, pushing them into the fringes of society. Most of us listening to this don't have to deal with the reality of war, but there's a different type of war now, isn't there? There's the war of busyness, the war, you know, of the outer world, the constant, you know, progress of the course of human evolution. You know, our businesses, our busyness, our pauses now are how we escape. It's the way we can escape into the mountain realms, You know, a pause from your busy day, just a moment, just a few breaths, just drops you right into those mountain realms. So the great question for me is this: how to escape without leaving? How to embody deep peace in the cells of your body without having to retire to the mountain silences? And my answer is the pause. Through small pauses cultivated daily. And you have to make this a discipline. The discipline is just to stop. To stare into the middle distance. Not to rush from one activity to the next, but to pause between activities. And an even more advanced level, to pause in the middle of activity. And then let the flood of the pauses slowly colonize your life until you feel pregnant with pauses, with the silence. And then you even become a pause. You become, your presence becomes a pause for others. And the moment others step into your aura, they can feel it. You're moving at the pace of that old tortoise. For that time, you become the mountain. You become the wild river with the clouds hanging over it. You become the lonesome hermit with their old staff in their hand, clambering over the mossy rocks, staring into those waterfalls. And so we come to the beginning, to the source of this tradition of ancient Chinese poetics. And his name is Dao Qian. He lived in the 5th century, some 300 years or so before Coal Mountain. And what I like about his poems is that he is a recluse, but he's also human. He has a family. He drinks wine. You know, he's actually credited with the inception of this whole rivers and mountains wilderness poetic tradition. But you have to understand a little of the background again. Northern China had been invaded by the barbarians, the Mongols, warlike people from the steppes. And this rather refined, aesthetic, spiritual, artist, you know, intellectual class, you know, all these people from the north headed south, they were forced south, where they came to this incredible landscape of serene mountain peaks and mists. You know, and because the local governments were also fraught with corruption, you know, that even more forced these refined thinkers further into the mountains just to escape it all. And in addition to this, the ancient Taoist tradition was undergoing a revival. And it was mingling with the Indian thought that came from Buddhism, brought by the likes of Bodhidharma, great master. And the result was this melting pot, a kind of perfect storm of conditions for a breakthrough in spiritual evolution. You know, the confluence of two great contemplative traditions, Taoist and Buddhist, Chinese and Indian, set against this awesome backdrop. And out of this emerged the tradition of Zen, the crystallization of the Dharma lineages into a new vision of enlightened human awareness. And Dao Qian, he stepped into this frame. And his poetry expresses perhaps the purest form of ecstasy that there can be. The ecstasy of ordinariness. You know, what do I mean by that? How can the ordinary be ecstatic? You know, these two things, they seem diametrically opposed. And yet in paradox often dwells wisdom. Dao Qian, an apt name. Qian meaning hidden. Dao meaning path. So Dao and Xie Ling, who I mentioned earlier, essentially they're these two counterparts. Xie's poetics are rooted in a wild kind of alpine vision of empty mind. And this is the ecstasy of emptiness. And Dao's poetics began the what's called the fields and gardens tradition, you know, because he lived in a little remote village among simple folk with a family, very poor, and chose to lead this simple peasant life. You know, and he was an aristocrat by birth. So his poetry takes us deep into everyday life. Here's an example. In reply to Mulberry Bramble Lou. In this meagre home, guests rare, I often forget I'm surrounded by turning seasons. And now falling leaves litter courtyard emptiness. I grow sadder, realizing it's autumn already. Fresh sunflower thickets fill north windows. Sweet grains in south fields ripen. Though I'm far from happy today, I know next year may never come. Get the children together, I call to my wife. It's the perfect day for a nice long walk. This is Dao's poetry. Here he is, melancholic, ordinary, just like us, just like us. But his poetry also takes us into something hidden. It is the quintessence of what became Zen. Zen is about the immediate. It's just this. Here, now, nothing else, nothing added. And this is a completely different form of ecstasy. We may not even recognize this as ecstasy because it isn't in any way extreme. You see, Cold Mountain, you know, he takes us into the extremes. Extreme cold, extreme high altitude, sometimes extreme laughter, and sometimes extreme behavior. But from Dao, we get some fundamental insights. One of these insights is called Tsujin. Tsujin is the process by which being arises from the emptiness of non-being. So this for me is the ancient Chinese word code for ecstasy, Tsujin. This is the basis of this form of empty ecstasy. The Tao or the way is kind of like their word for God or for the divine, though it doesn't have this sense of being a kind of being. It is being itself. And Tsujin could, in that instance, be seen a little bit like the will of God. So if you have God and then you have the God of the will of God, you have the Tao and then Tsujin, because Tsujin is how things arise. So the Tao is the what and Tsujin is the how. Literally, it can be translated as self ablaze. And there we have a kind of keyhole into the ecstatic realm, self ablaze. And Dao's poems and all the poetry of this entire Chinese tradition describe Tsujin, life arising and falling back into itself. The poetry itself is not really an art form. It's not intended as an art. It goes way further. It's a living meditative discipline. Now, these poems, they detonate spontaneously within the sage. And the Chinese language itself is formed around this insight of Sujin. You know, the poems rarely make personal comments. I've read some today. But they often, what they do is they just describe happenings or things. Mountains, leaves, the mist, dogs barking, the smell of musk. Sometimes a human emotion falls into the emptiness. But the language itself is Spartan. So it gives the feeling of the emptiness, of the silence, of the watcher, the witness. And this is what led to the art of haiku, incredible distilled wordings, or even to the Zen koan, the use of words to accentuate the wordless. And this is the magic I'm attempting to touch here today, this silence from which ecstasy is born. So don't be fooled into equating emptiness with sadness. Some of these poems may seem sad to us. They speak of death, of fading, of autumn, of evening, of all that is ephemeral. And the Eastern traditions lean more towards the sunset, whereas the Western traditions point us more towards the sunrise, the full heart as opposed to the empty mind. But they're the same, East and West. Empty mind, full heart. Full heart, empty mind. The Chinese have a word, xin. And it's in that word, we see the secret that there's no distinguishing between heart and mind. Think about that. Contemplate that. How your heart feels is how your mind thinks or doesn't think. So when your heart is full, your mind is empty. And when your mind is empty, your heart is full. 100,000 sparrows descend on my empty courtyard. A few gather atop the plums, chatting with clear evening skies. And the rest swarm around, trying to murder me with their racket. Suddenly, they all startle away, and there's silence, not a sound. The sparrows. Those lines were written 800 years after Tao by Yang Wangli, Zen master standing at the culmination of the rivers and mountain lineage. And this tradition continues even until this day. But Yang Wangli perfected its simple beauty. No one can take it any further. The transmission was perfected in him. So there is no beginning or end to this tradition. Just these words arising ecstatically from the wordless, sinking back again to the wordless. Our lives are these words. We are the words. Living. Dying. Being born again. Dying again. Endlessly. You see, it's nature who shows us the way. This wilderness. Beneath the stones and the rocks, and the rivers, are the words of God. And if we're able to listen attentively for a long, long time. We may hear those words. The words are hidden everywhere. Just need some time, some attention, some space. And then the outer wilderness awakens within us through resonance, through affinity. We feel the pulse of the divine. We become the mountain of awakening. We enter the river of now. So I'd like to end at the beginning with Hanshan, Cold Mountain. Who was he? We shall never know. We don't know who he was. We don't even accurately know when he was. Nor we have these words and the legend of his passing. It's said that he was last seen entering into a crack in the mountain where he lived, in a cave. He waved goodbye and gave a shout, and then the mountain closed behind him, swallowing him. The multitude of stars is the late night's light, alone above a cliff before the moon sets. The perfect luminescence, the unpolished glow, hanging in the sky, is my mind. Old and sick, final years over 100, face brown, head white, content with mountain life. Cloth robe pulled tight, I accept my karma. Why would I envy the clever ways of others?